Hi guys, my name is Neha Gupta and I am your mentor for current affairs at anujjindal.in. So we have again resumed the series of morning tales which we have to stop for unforeseen circumstances last year. So this morning tale series has proven itself to be very useful for the students of prominently the students of RBI, SEBI, NABARD or those who are appearing for any kind of banking examination. So we have again brought this series for you guys, and I am your mentor here who will tell you to how to memorize the current affairs in a simpler and easy way so that your effort for remembering the current affairs reduces to the minimum. So that is my motto here, to reduce the efforts of my students. So without wasting any delay, let's begin today's session. But before beginning the session, let me tell you, subscribe to our channel and hit the bell notification so that when the next time I come on the channel with this morning tale series, you get the notification instantly. So why wait? Do hit the subscribe button and the notification bell. Now this slide reminds me to tell you that we have a Telegram channel where we conduct daily quizzes as well as we connect with our students. Basically, if you have any kinds of doubts that you are unable to resolve here in the comment section, then you can also connect with us on the Telegram channel. Now here, apart from asking your doubts, you can also have guidance from us. You can also ask for guidance if you need any kind of guidance for examination purpose and for career purposes. So why wait? Again, I would tell you why wait. Just join our Telegram channel. The link of the channel has been given in the description box below. So in this slide, we have the table of contents, what the things that we are going to discuss. And again, I would repeat that my motto is to reduce your effort to the minimum in remembering the current affairs, because current affairs is defined by facts. Basically, there are a lot of facts that you need to cover. So this reminds me of our magazine, Spotlight. So this magazine, Spotlight, many students have told me that this contains a lot of facts, and we face problems in memorizing the facts presented in this magazine. So my motto here is to reduce your efforts, and I will pick up 5 questions on a daily basis from Spotlight magazine itself and try to reduce your burden of memorizing the current affairs. So that was all that I wanted to say. Now let's quickly jump on to the index. So our first topic will be Banking Regulation Amendment Bill 2020, PASEX naval exercise that has been conducted by India with a country that we will discuss later on in this video. But for now, let's discuss the topic so that you get the broader idea of what are the things that we are going to cover in this video later on. Then we will be discussing about UN Climate Global Summit, UN CTAGS, basically UN's Conference on Trade and Development. So this UN CTAD has released its Trade and Development Report 2020, and we will be discussing the details of this report in this video. Lastly, we have a technical group on Social Stock Exchange. So what is this Social Stock Exchange? What are the functions of this technical group? And lastly, who heads this group? So these are the things that we are going to discuss in this topic. So let's begin our session for today with our first question. So basically our first question says that the Banking Regulation Amendment Bill has been passed by the Parliament. Parliament refers to both houses. So Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha both have passed this bill. So there are high chances that the provisions mentioned in this bill would translate into an act after the President of India, who is Ram Nath Kovind. So when he signs this bill, it will become an act. So there are very less chances that new amendments or new provisions will be added to the bill. That is why I have picked up this bill at this stage when it has been passed by the Parliament, both houses of the Parliament. So let's discuss what are the provisions of this question, or basically the amendment bill. So the amendment bill seeks to change which act? So basically, this is an amendment bill. So definitely, this amends an act. So which act is this? It is Banking Regulation Act 1949. Now let's discuss the provisions of this act. The most important function that this amendment bill does is that it includes the cooperative banks under the aegis of RBI. So basically, all the functions, all the banking functions of cooperative banks will be from now onwards handled by RBI. Handled here refers to administered or regulated by RBI. So that is the major important function that is being performed by this bill. Now, why is there need to bring cooperative banks under RBI? The need is to prevent frauds, like we had faced the fraud in PMC, Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank. So PMC fraud happened in 2019, and this fraud has led to the development of this bill, and this bill includes these provisions. Now, what is the power that this bill gives to RBI? First of all, it gives the power to RBI to regulate the banking functions of cooperative banks, and the administrative functions of cooperative banks will be under registrar of cooperative societies. So this is a very important question, because it can also be asked in the examination that who will handle the administrative processes of cooperative banks. So it is the registrars of cooperative societies. Now, let's discuss the provisions of this act in detail. First of all, what is the power given to RBI? Basically, under this amendment bill, which has not been converted into an act yet. So under this bill, RBI gets the power to supersede any decision of the board of directors. So basically, if the board of director of cooperative banks takes any decision, so RBI has the power to supersede that decision for 5 years without even consulting the state government. So basically, earlier the state governments were the major stakeholders, and RBI did not have that much involvement in cooperative bank functioning. But now, this involvement of RBI has been increased, and RBI can supersede any decision of board of directors of these cooperative banks in the interest of depositors. So basically, that is the first major important fact about this amendment bill. Now, this amendment bill will also entail benefits for the cooperative banks. What are the benefits? First, and the major benefit that cooperative banks will get is that they can raise money, raise capital from capital markets. Before this, they were not allowed to raise capital from capital markets, because that is the basic idea of cooperative society. The members of the society or the cooperative banks used to give the deposits, used to contribute the money to the bank. Now, the banks can raise capital from the market in the form of equity as well as debts. So basically, this will definitely increase the capital base of these cooperative banks as well as their functioning. Now, cooperative banks are quite closer to rural areas as well as farmers. So these cooperative banks will definitely prove to be a tool in the development of rural areas as well as farmers and agricultural areas. So that was the major benefit for cooperative banks. Now let's discuss about certain exemptions given under this act. Bill, sorry. सो exemptions. Which cooperative bank is not covered under this bill? So first is agricultural credit societies, and second is cooperative land mortgage banks. So these are the two cooperative societies which have been exempted from the from this bill. So basically these two organizations, these two societies will not be administered by RBI. Now one thing or the one order that has been passed for these organizations is that they cannot use the word bank, banking in their name. They have to mention it clearly that they are agricultural cooperative society or land mortgage agency. They cannot use the word bank in their names in order to bring transparency and to increase the understanding of the people. So basically the rural citizens do not understand what a bank or what a cooperative society is for them. Any society which give any institution that lends money to them is equivalent to a bank. So basically, in order to remove this this confusion, this step has been taken by the government. So we have discussed everything about this bill, and there is nothing to discuss in this bill anymore. So we will directly jump to our second question of the day, that is the PASEX naval exercise. So basically, this PASEX naval exercise has been done, has been conducted with Japan and US as well. In the month of July, so basically in the month of July, Japan, US, India has conducted the PASEX exercise, naval exercise with US as well as with Japan. Now, in the exercise with US Nimitz, which is the world's largest warship, was deployed. So do remember this thing, because it can also be asked in the exam that in which naval exercise did US deploy its US Nimitz aircraft warship. In which naval exercise with India, conducted with India, does US deploy its US Nimitz warship? So this is another way that this question can be asked. Therefore, it is very important. Or directly, they can ask you the name of the world's largest warship or the country which possesses this world's largest warship. So do remember this fact as well. Now, these exercises were conducted in July. Right now, in the month of September, this exercise has been conducted with another country. Now, I am giving you a hint so that you can yourself guess that what is the answer of this question. So, the hint is that the answer to this question is a member of Quad Countries Group. Now, can you guess? Come on, give me your answers in the comment section that which country are we talking about here? Come on, guys. So it is Australia. Quad refers to four. So four countries are members of this grouping: Japan, Australia, US, and India. Now, these four countries collaborated in order to counter Chinese influence in the Indian Ocean region. If you want to remember the Quad countries, the member of Quad countries, you can also remember it in this way. Here is something Japan, here is Japan, here is India, then we have Australia, then we have US, and this region is Indian Ocean region. Now, do not confuse it with the actual map, guys. This is just an illustration I am drawing for you so that you can easily remember the members of this Quad group and the purpose of this Quad group. So this group has been formed in order to counter Chinese influence on the Indian Ocean region. So basically, all the four countries, Japan, India, Australia, and US, are protecting the Indian Ocean region. So basically, these countries are countering the Chinese influence. I hope that it is clear for you. And I'm again saying, do not target me, do not criticize me on the basis of this map. This is just an illustration for your understanding. As I told you in the beginning, my motto is to reduce your efforts. So this is a step towards that direction. So I think we have discussed everything regarding this question. Now I have a question for you guys. Can you tell me that who is the Prime Minister of Australia? Do mention your answers in the comment section below. And like this, we can cover various interesting questions on Telegram also. So do join our Telegram channel. The link is in the description below. Now our third question is UN's Global Climate Summit 2020. Now this summit will be held towards the end of this year in November, December. With which country will the UN co-host this summit? Now, before answering this question, let me tell you that this summit is a precursor to the COP26 of UNFCCC. What is this COP26 of UNFCCC? COP is Conference of Parties. Now, what is Conference of Parties? It is basically a summit. You can understand it in this way, that COP is equivalent to a summit. This is the 26th edition of that summit, and UNFCCC stands for United Nations Framework Convention for Climate Change. So, Convention for Climate Change. This COP26 will be held in the year 2021. And will be hosted by United Kingdom in Glasgow. So basically will be held in Glasgow in UK. Okay, that is clear that we are going to have a COP26 of UNFCCC that will be held in 2021 by UK in Glasgow. Okay, so, and this Global Climate Summit is a precursor to this COP26. Now guys, can you get the link? Can you connect these two summits? Okay, so I'm giving you 2 seconds, connect them. The connection between the two summits is that the co-host is the same, basically UK. So UK is going to host this UN Global Climate Summit and COP26 of UNFCCC, FCCC. So that was the main connection between these two summits. Now, I don't think that I need to elaborate on the purpose of these summits because the name itself is suggesting the purpose. It is for the climate change, to counter the climate change. So that was all that we have to discuss about this question. Now comes our fourth question, which is very, very important. Do listen to me carefully throughout the question. So recently, UNCTAD, first of all, stands for UN Conference on Trade and Development. So now, it's quite easy for you guys to remember that which organization releases the Trade and Development Report 2020. Now, the name itself is suggesting that Trade and Development Report must be released by Trade and Development Organization. Okay, so the other way around this question can be asked is that which organization releases the Trade and Development Report? So they can give you many options like International Monetary Fund, World Bank, or European Bank, or any multilateral agency, Asian Development Bank, or the United Nations. So you have to directly tick on United Nations because I don't think that now you have to put in extra effort in remembering the name of the organization that releases this report. Okay. So we have discussed the very first basic fact about this report, that which organization releases it? It United Nations. And which branch of United Nations? It is the Conference of Trade and Development. Okay. Now, before discussing the answer of this question, before discussing about the remittances, let us first discuss about the GDP projections that this report has made. So this table and this poverty alert, I have made this in such a way that if you click a screenshot and watch this slide later on as well, you can easily remember the forecast as well as the projection given by this report. So GDP forecast for FY21 is 2022-21. For world it is -4.3, for India it is -4.9. Now, since these forecasts are being changed regularly on a daily basis, we can say, so you don't need to remember the previous forecast. You just remember the latest forecast being told by the organization. Now we have the forecast for 2021 to 2022, that is financial year FY 2022. In this year, we are expected to face a positive growth rate globally as well as in India. Now, this declining or this contracting GDP growth rate alerts us about the increasing poverty level, because if the GDP is declining, the income of people is declining. And if the income is declining, poverty is increasing. So what this report say about the increasing poverty? How much people are going to be affected by this income loss? Obviously, almost all the world is affected, but there is only a chunk of people who will be pushed into extreme poverty. Now, what is the amount or what is the quantity of the people? So it is 90 to 120 million people. So these people will be pushed into extreme poverty in the developing world, with close to 300 people facing food insecurity. So this is the impact of COVID-19. This is the tremendous impact that the world is going to face, and particularly the developing world, because developed countries have developed infrastructure, have already developed their infrastructure and facilities to accommodate the economic crisis. But developing countries like us, like India, we don't have that much facilities. So therefore, we are at a greater risk of being affected by the COVID-19. So just do remember the numbers. 90 to 120 million will be the amount of people who will be pushed into extreme poverty. And 300 million people will face food insecurity. And these forecasts, you have to remember them ultimately. So do remember these forecasts as well. Now let's come back to our question. So our question says that what is the global remittances drop? By how much will the global remittances will drop? So the amount is 100 billion. Nothing to discuss much, because if the income is declining, then obviously the remittances will also decline. But guys, do you know what remittances are? Remittances are the money, are the money that the people send from one country to another country. Why do the people send money from one country to another country? Suppose I work in UK, my family reside in India. If I earn in UK, then obviously I will send money to my family for their sustenance as well. So the money that I will be sending from UK to India will be the remittance from UK to India. So remittances basically is the private money, is the money that is being sent from by the family members to their family members. But they also add to the national GDP or the global GDP in the larger context. So basically, this is the 100 billion fall that we are going to face in remittances at the global level. Trade, let's talk about trade. So trade is expected to decline by 1/5. So basically the 100% was the trade before COVID-19. After this, we are going to face a shortage of 1/5. So by 1/5 proportion, the trade in the world will decline. FDI flows, 40% decline. Now do remember this thing that we are talking about the global scenario. It is nowhere written, or I have not said that it is related to India. Obviously, we are part of the globe. So obviously, we will be affected by this impact also. But these numbers are not for India specifically. These are the global numbers. Do remember this thing as well. Now we have discussed everything about this report. Now I have a question for you guys. You have to tell me that who is the Secretary General of UN General Assembly. Okay, so this is your question for the day. You have to tell me who is the Secretary General of UNGA in the comment section below. I will be waiting for your answers in the comment section. So do not forget to give me your answers. And this is our last question of the day that we are going to discuss, and equivalently important. Last doesn't mean least. So it is very important. Do listen to me very carefully in this question. So this question says us that a technical group has been formed on social stock exchange. What is this social stock exchange? Basically, the idea of social stock exchange was proposed in the year 2019. Social stock, the name is very obvious, the name is very easy, and the purpose is also easy. If you remember the name and the purpose, you will easily understand the meaning of this social stock exchange. So basically, the social stock exchange aims to help the social organizations like NGOs or the private organizations or individuals who are working for social welfare. Now, how is this exchange going to help the people or the organization? This social stock exchange will help them to list themselves on this exchange and raise money. So what is the two-folded purpose of this stock exchange? First is to allow NGOs or the social welfare organization to list themselves on this exchange, and secondly, to help them to raise money. So that is the major purpose of this social stock exchange. In which year was it introduced? It was introduced in the year 2019. Okay, so that was all about the background of this exchange. Now, in June 2020 itself, a working group of SEBI, which is headed by Ishaat Hussain. So he is the person who headed this working group of SEBI, which submitted its recommendations to SEBI. And what was in the recommendations? So the recommendations largely mentioned that there is a need for us to develop operational guidelines for this social stock exchange. Basically, any organization or any kind of project won't work if we don't have a blueprint of that organization, of the functions of that organization. So this technical group has been set up to develop or to frame or to draft that framework of this social stock exchange. So quite easy to remember the purpose of this organization, which organization has has formed this technical group. It is SEBI. Now this is also very easy to remember because we are talking about a stock exchange. So it is quite easy for us to remember the organization which has formed this technical group. And what is the function of that group? To prepare the operational guidelines for this stock exchange, for this social stock exchange. What is the purpose of social stock exchange? To help the social welfare organizations to list themselves in order to raise funds. So quite easy if you remember it through a story. Okay, that SEBI has formed a technical group, The technical group aims to develop the frame operational guidelines for the social stock exchange. Social stock exchange is the exchange which helps the social welfare companies or organizations like NGOs to list themselves in order to raise funds. Now, this idea was proposed in the year 2019. So this is basically a chain. If you remember it in a chain, then you will never forget these facts. Now let's discuss the answer to this question. And the answer is Harsh Kumar Bhanwal. Guys, there is a specific speciality of this person. Can you tell me in the comment section that what is the speciality I'm talking about? Okay, so let me tell you. So it is Harsh Kumar Bhanwal was the former chairman of NABARD. So that is the speciality I was talking about. Now guys, you don't need to remember this thing that he was the former chairman of NABARD. That I told you out of curiosity. I wanted to share this fact with you guys, so I told you. But you don't need to remember it, okay? Because already you have a lot to remember. And these unimportant facts are not required to be memorized by you guys, okay? So here ends our session for the day. I hope that you have liked our session and you will again come to this series of Morning Tales tomorrow. Thank you so much. Good luck, and do not forget to subscribe to our channel. Thank you.